and keep them working. Parenting beyond your capacity.
Well, hello everybody, and welcome to our webinar on Parenting Beyond Your Capacity. That was just a little promo for the book that we're going to be looking at tonight by Carrie Newhoff and Reggie Joyner. And it centers around this word called capacity. So I wanted to start by actually just looking at a definition for capacity, which is the maximum amount that something can contain. And when I think of the word capacity, I actually think of a suitcase that my family owns. You know, when you travel, although we're not doing a lot of that today in our time of a global pandemic, but when you travel and you pack things in a suitcase, and oftentimes it's never big enough. You fill it to the brim, and sometimes you have to like sit on it, or you have to push it down in order to zip it up. Well, our suitcase has an expandable top. So it has this zipper that if you zip all the way on the outside, a little tiny compartment expands the suitcase so you can fit more in. And it increases the capacity of the suitcase. So when I think of capacity, this is what I think of. But when I think of parenting, I also think of capacity. I think of the fact that as a parent, I have a certain amount of capacity. In any given day, I only have a certain amount of time, right? I only have a certain amount of resources, a certain amount of patience, and sometimes I reach my capacity. And I realize very quickly that parenting is something that I cannot do on my own. I need supports. I need a strategic community around me to help me in raising my kids. And I'm sure you found the same to be true for you, that parenting is something we can't do alone. I don't know about you, but especially in this time of social isolation and family quarantine, where a lot of the other activities and communities and supports that my family has had have kind of been removed from us in a lot of different ways, this has become even more apparent and more real for me that I can't do this thing of parenting on my own. And so I want to be able to leverage others around me and the resources that I have to strengthen me as a parent, but also to help my kids have a better opportunity to be influenced and impacted in their lives. So this is the whole premise behind the book, that we as parents recognize our own capacity, but we can still look for ways to expand that capacity so that we can be better parents in the end. So one of the things that the book starts off talking about is actually something called stock family syndrome. And I'm sure that you have felt it in many ways in your own life, where it's this idea where we feel like we should be this family on the left, the Pinterest family, right? The social media family, where a perfect image is captured in a moment of time. Everyone's smiling and everyone's dressed to match and everything looks perfect. And it is a great, beautiful picture. But in reality, I think most of the time we feel like our families are on the right-hand side of the picture, where actually it says fail, but I don't think fail's the right word. I think that it's actually realistic, that realistically, this is what our families look like most of the time. And if we look at the Bible, actually, we see that God actually reminds us time and time again that people are not perfect, that families are not perfect. You don't have to dig too far into the scriptures to see stories of imperfect families, which can maybe make us feel a little bit better, right? Noah had a drinking problem. Abraham actually offered up his wife to another man. We see Rebecca and her youngest son, Jacob, deceive Isaac and steal the birthright from Esau. We see deception in the family. We see David who had an affair. And the reality is that all of our families are different. We carry different stress points and difficulties in our family lives. Some of us have divorced or divided families. Some are blended families. Some families deal with deep addictions. Some families deal with mental health issues, with financial stressors. There's lots of different things that cause our families to not be perfect, at least not perfect all the time. And I don't know, maybe you feel like this is encouraging in some ways, but maybe in other ways you feel, well, what's the point? How can I be a good parent if my family is just going to fall into the realities of chaos every day? Well, here's a great quote from the book that I think is very redemptive. It's on page 47 in the book, and it says that God is at work telling a story of restoration and redemption through your family. No matter what your family looks like or how limited your capacity might be, you can cooperate with whatever God desires to do in your heart, so your children will have a front row seat to the grace and goodness of God. And I love this. I love that even though we are not perfect as parents, even though our families are not perfect together in our family unit, that God desires to do a work in all of us so that we as parents can be restored and redeemed, and that our kids too can be restored and redeemed and have a front row seat to the grace and the goodness of God. I really love this quote. And so the book is built upon this idea of God at work in our families. And there are three main points or truths that this book kind of leans on a number of times. And here they are. The first is that no one has more potential to influence your child than you. Just from the capacity of time alone, the amount of time you spend with your children, especially between the ages of birth to 18, you spend the most time with your kids. So you have the most potential to influence your child. And that is always going to be true. You are a powerful force of influence in your kid's life. But the second thing is also true, that you are not the only influence that your children need. We have to remember that we have a capacity and that we need to rely on others in order to help us and to leverage our parenting so that we can better influence our children. Which is point number three, right? Two combined influences will make a greater impact than just two influences, right? So this is the idea of synergy. I can lift 5 pounds, you can lift 10 pounds, but if we work together, we can lift 15 pounds. So we're better when we work together on raising our kids, in working in family life, in being supported as parents. So these are kind of three pillar truths that this book is built upon. And then the book kind of talks about five values that can help us grow in our capacity and maximize our influence in our families and in our parenting. So I'm just gonna spend the next few minutes going through them rather quickly, giving some personal examples from the book, but also from my own life. And hopefully you find something in here that is useful to you in your current stage of life and of parenting and of family. That's at least my hope and my prayer. Maybe it creates some deeper thinking in you on some certain things, or maybe it just re-emphasizes for you the fact that, yeah, we're on the right track. I'm doing these things as a parent. Great. Keep doing them. Keep building your capacity and your support system around you. Okay? So here we go. Let's talk about the five values. The first one is the value of widening your circle. And by this, they mean allowing other people to intentionally invest in your children, adding their voices and their wisdom into your kids' lives that will help shape and determine the direction of their lives. And at North Park Community Church, this is why we believe that church community is so important, and that intentionally and consistently showing up to church really makes a difference in your family's life. Now, I realize that you can't make it to church every single Sunday, especially with young families. It can be so hard just to get out the door and make it there. And sometimes with sickness or with a jam-packed schedule, I realize that sometimes church just can't happen on a Sunday morning. But the reality is that in a community of faith, we're developing relationships for our kids of other adults and other peers who are going to be able to speak into our kids' lives and into our lives as parents. And if we attend church maybe once or twice a month, the reality is that that's not going to be enough of time to develop these relationships. So we need to intentionally and consistently widen the circle. And church community is one way that we can do that. But you think of the many influences that our kids have, their teachers, their coaches, our neighbors, our friends. All of these people are part of this circle of influence that our family has and that are that impact our kids' lives. So we need to intentionally think about widening the circle so that these voices, these adults and peers, are speaking truth into our kids' lives. So I like to think of it, here's a quote from the book that talks about widening the circle. It says, "The goal is for you to pursue strategic relationships so other adult voices will speak into your son's or daughter's life, saying the kinds of things you would try to say as a parent." So as I said, we're surrounding our families and our kids with people who would say the kinds of things that we would say to our kids. Because we know sometimes our kids won't listen to us, but they might listen to another trusted adult in their life who we have cultivated a relationship with. So we need to widen the circle. Here's an image that I think of, right? It's a bullseye or a target. And of course, we're shooting for the middle. You want to aim for a goal, a desired target. But I like to think of it too as maybe a stunt person's pillow, right, that they jump into. Imagine they jump off a tall building, and of course they're going to aim for the middle. That's what they're shooting for. But what if they go a little off to the right or a little off to the left? Well, that cushion, that circle of influence, first of all, you want it to be as big as possible because that allows for error. But when we land in that spot, imagine the pillow cushion kind of rolling the stunt person into the middle, into that desired target. And this is what our circle of influence is, what we want it to do for us, is that these other people in our community, that when our kids kind of land a bit off center, they're going to roll them back into the middle and that desired target. And what is that middle, that desired target? Well, part of it is us as parents, our relationship with our kids, and a good relationship with our kids. But ultimately, and spiritually speaking, it's God. God is the center of our lives and God is the center of our families. And so we want this circle of influence to fold us as parents and to fold our kids back into the middle and the center, which is God. So my challenge here is for you to just think about whatever stage of life you're in. Who is the circle of influence? Who are the people? Can you name them? And are you intentionally and consistently building these relationships into their lives? Maybe this is something that you need to continue to build upon, or maybe this is something that you need to start to build upon. And the earlier you do it in your kid's life, and the more consistent you can keep these relationships, the greater the impact is going to be over the course of their lifetime. I know of a couple of families who during this time of quarantine have reached out. One is at a birthday, and they reached out to a circle of influence and they said, "Would you write a note to my daughter who's having a birthday? Because you are a meaningful voice in her life and we can't have a normal birthday, but we would love for you to send a note to her." Another is a family who has a grade 8 graduate, and they have reached out to their circle of influence, and they have asked people to write a note to their son who's graduating from grade 8, words of affirmation to him, a reminder to him of who he is and how he is loved in community and by God himself. So these are some creative ways that this wider circle of influence helps us increase our capacity in our parenting and helps our kids come back to the center of a life in Christ. So that's value number one. Value number two is imagining the end. And by this, we're talking about focusing our energy and our efforts on the things that will have lasting impact. Our days are made up of moments, and many moments are battles. Many moments are things that we just need to fight through and persevere through. And it can be tough in the day-to-day grind. But if we can imagine the end and we can see the big picture of our kids' lives, it can help increase our capacity. So it's a little bit like reading the last chapter of a book or seeing the end of a movie before you start it. And you realize that along the way, there's going to be bumps. There's going to be struggles and hardship. But what we want to do is we want to keep our focus long term. We want to keep the focus on where we want our kids to end up. And yes, those day-to-day moments matter. They matter a lot. But those day-to-day moments, we want to lead our kids in a certain direction. So if we can keep the end in mind, if we can imagine where we want our kids to go ultimately, it helps us maybe not be so consumed with those immediate frustrations of the day. As frustrating as they may be, they're valid, but they might just help us put them in perspective and see the bigger picture. So an example of this in my life is, I know my junior high years, my mom would tell you, if she was right here with us on this webinar, she would tell you that I was not her favorite person during the junior high years. And my mom let me know it. She corrected me and she instructed me, and we had our share of frustrations in those years. But she also never gave up on me. And nowadays, I know my mom would say, well, you didn't turn out too bad. Right? And I think this is the idea of imagining the end, that there are going to be seasons of real struggle and seasons of real hardship. And I don't want to minimize those. But I think as parents, we need to sometimes step back and imagine the end and see a bigger picture in mind. So to illustrate this, the book talks about this on page 89. It says, when I imagine the end, it enables me to distinguish more clearly between what matters and what matters most. So again, here's this idea that moments matter. Every moment does matter. Don't hear me wrong on that. But some moments matter more than others. So we need to kind of maybe choose our point of emphasis each and every day and each and every season so that we can lead our children to that desired end that we hope and dream for them. And to illustrate this, I think of this picture. I think of camping. Now, this is a little bit of stock family syndrome here that's going on. I don't know if you're a big camper, and if you are and you camp well, maybe this is what camping looks like for you. This idyllic picture of everyone behaving well and things so organized and green and lush and beautiful, everyone's smiling. But I know, and we enjoy camping, but we're not very good campers. Camping is a lot of work. Camping, depending on the weather, can be really difficult if you're not properly set up for it. And I remember reading a blog once of a mom who wrote and said, you know, every year we go camping and every year it seems to be a disaster, of course, mixed in with some good memories. But she says it's so much work. We are exhausted. Nobody sleeps well when we're camping. We get home from camping and then we've got all this cleanup to do and we need to almost rest from our camping time. This was her reality. And she started to question, why do we do this? Why do we go camping every year if it's this much work and this much struggle? But what she said is, what I realized is I don't do camping for the camping experience alone in that moment, even though there are good moments in that experience. She says, when I'm camping, I'm thinking of 5 years down the road, 10 years down the road, when my kids are more grown and they look back and they say, remember when we used to go camping as a family and sit around the campfire? And they'll remember those good moments. Hopefully they remember those good moments. But it's having that idea of imagining the end and seeing the big picture, not just being caught up in the here and now, which is so easy to do in our parenting. But to expand your capacity, we need to have a bigger picture of what God is desiring to do in the story that he is telling in our lives. The third value is fighting for the heart. Now, what does fighting for the heart mean? Fighting for the heart means that we create a place of unconditional love in our homes. Now, of course, our homes are not a place of unconditional love. We fight in our homes. But they differentiate in this chapter, in this value, the difference between fighting with our kids or with our spouse or with our family and fighting for our kids or fighting for our spouse or fighting for our family. And there's a big difference in this. We will fight with one another. When we live together in close proximity for an extended period of time, we see the best in each other, but we also see the worst in each other. And you know what? Our families will fight with each other. But ultimately, we want our kids to know that even when we fight with each other, we will never stop fighting for our kids, for the best for our kids, desiring that for them in their lives. So here's a great quote from the book. It says, during the formative and teenage years, it's actually more essential for the parents to earn trust with the child than it is for the child to earn trust with the parents. Now, I had to read this a couple times at first, right? Because it's a little bit backwards to what we think, right? But it's really important. What they're saying is that it's really, really important that we as parents earn the trust of our kids, right? That we need our kids to learn to trust us. They'll see us in our imperfect moments. They'll see when we fight with them, but they'll trust us if we know that ultimately we will fight for them. That no matter what they're experiencing, when they mess up, when they have difficulty in life, we will fight for them. We will be there for them. We will forgive them. We will work through the difficulties, and that we are always on their side, that they can always come back to us. So for this, I illustrate it with this picture. Now, I don't know if you're a basketball fan. Maybe you hate basketball. I love basketball. But this is a fellow named Dennis Rodman. He was a unique individual, to say the least. I would not recommend copying his lifestyle, but some would say he was the best rebounder in basketball history. It was one thing that he was really, really known for. And a rebound in basketball is when a shot is taken, and let's say it misses, and it bounces off the rim or bounces off the backboard, and it can fly anywhere. It's a missed shot. Well, some team needs to gain possession of that ball. And Dennis Rodman was the best, or one of the best in the game, of gathering those rebounds. When there was a miss, he would go with hunger and pursuit and purpose towards grabbing that ball. And you can see him there in the picture, right? He is possessively holding onto that ball. And so for me, in a weird kind of a way, maybe this image doesn't work for you, but it does for me. It reminds me that as a parent, when my kid misses in life, when my kid has an experience where they bang off the rim of life or off the backboard of life, I will be there to gather them and protect them and cover them and take possession of them again and get going in a good direction again. I think this is what fighting for the heart is all about. That our kids need to know that we are for them and that we will always be for them, no matter what. Because the truth is that God treats us this way, right? No matter how much we've messed up, He is always for us. He's always pursuing us, ready to shelter us and to bring us back into His arms and to hold us and carry us forward. God is always fighting for our hearts. We need to fight for the hearts of our kids. Value number four is creating a rhythm. And I'll admit, during this time again of quarantine with COVID-19, we've had to create entirely new rhythms and schedules for our families. And it's been difficult. At least it has been for my family. I'm sure you found the struggles to be very real for you as well. But here's the thing. What creates a rhythm is not necessarily the big moments. The big moments create an impact, right? COVID-19 has created a massive impact in our world and in our families. But that doesn't create a rhythm. What creates a rhythm is the small everyday moments of life, right? Like the steady beat behind a music, right? It's those steady notes that happen all throughout the piece that create a rhythm for that music. And it's the same for our lives. It's something we call habits. And I'm going to talk about habits in just a second, but I do want to give you this quote from the book first, because it reminds us, it says that parents who engage in small ways can make a big difference in the lives of their kids or teenagers. So parents, we have to remember that it's not always the big experiences that we give our kids, although those are important, those are impactful, those moments of vacation, those moments of big conversation, those are definitely important. But it's the small everyday rhythms and habits that we engage with our kids, that maybe it's just a minute here, a minute there. Those are the things that create a good rhythm and good habits in our family life. So when we talk about a habit, we talk about a settled or a regular tendency or practice, especially one that is hard to give up. And I love that after a period of time, our habits are hard to give up. Now, it can be a bad habit, which can be a bad thing. But if it's a good habit, it's one that our kids are always going to remember. So there's four really key times in the day for every person, but especially in our families. One is mealtime. We have to do this anyway. We embody, God put us in a physical body, and we need nourishment. We need to sit down or eat at least regularly every day. It's something we have to do. It's a habit we must maintain. And we want good eating habits. But we also can surround that moment with healthy spiritual habits. So that's why for a lot of families, saying a grace, a prayer before they eat is a great habit, because it reminds us of our thankfulness to God for what he provides, but it communicates consistently and intentionally to our kids that God is a part of our day, that God is a part of three times of our day, at least if you're eating three meals. Now, it doesn't mean you don't have to pray before every meal. It's not a rule. It's not something that is going to make or break your family life. But if you can set up good habits around your mealtime to celebrate family and to celebrate God and his goodness, that's going to have huge impact in your family's life. Drive time is important. I know when you have younger kids, it's difficult to have a drive time that's not chaotic, where a kid isn't screaming or unhappy about something. But as your kids get older, drive time is really important, at least before they get their own license and they're driving themselves to places. When you're driving your kids to practice, when you're driving to church, when you're driving to a friend's house, your kid can't go anywhere. They're buckled in with you. So use that time wisely to develop habits of asking good questions, of your kids, of talking about things. It's a great opportunity that happens every day anyway, so why don't you build a healthy habit into it? And then, of course, morning time and bedtime. When we see our kids in the morning, do we reinforce to them, hey, good morning, I love you, I hope you have a good day at school, even though we're not in school right now, but do we send a positive message every morning out with our kids? And every night at bedtime, do we have another prayer time? Or do we have a Bible verse that we talk about, or you say a blessing over your kid? You know, may the Lord bless you and keep you as you sleep. God loves you so much. Good night, right? It may seem small. It only takes 30 seconds, a minute, 2 minutes, but it can have a huge impact. Now, I know some of you might be saying, well, my kid is older and I go to bed before my kid, or my kid wakes up later than I do. You can still find creative ways to create healthy habits. I know some parents who will still text their adult children every night, good night, I love you, God loves you, take care. It might be the same thing in the morning, a phone call or an email or a text or something that's still consistent and regular. It's a habit that you build into your family, because this idea of creating a rhythm is so important in our families. And it doesn't take big, huge moments. It actually takes a bunch of little small moments and habits to create good rhythm and build good capacity into your everyday living as a family. All right. Value number five. This is the last one, and it's a little different. It's one that doesn't focus so much on your kid. It focuses on you as a parent. And what the book talks about by making it personal is that you need to take care of yourself as a parent. You need to make it personal for you. And this is counterintuitive to parents often. We're so busy taking care of our kids, especially when they're younger, or worrying about our kids when they're older, that we forget to take care of ourselves. And remember that first principle, that we as parents have the most potential to impact our kids' lives. So if that's true, we need to think about the fact that a lot of the time our kids, no matter what age they're in really, our kids are in a monkey see, monkey do type of scenario. And this might be scary for us, but our kids are always looking to us as an example of life. And if we're not taking time to care for ourselves, if we're not taking time to create good habits for ourselves personally, how will it ever be developed in our kids? So we need to take the time to make it personal. Here's a great quote from the book. When you make it personal, the story, remember that redemptive story that God is telling, lives in you. And then it's much easier for that story to one day be in them. Our kids need to see it in us if they're going to live it for themselves. Now, that's not an ultimatum, right? There's many stories where God has worked in our lives in spite of imperfect examples. But we as parents want to model the best we can a healthy life. And to do that, we need to take care of ourselves. So how do we do this? Well, it might be as simple as just enjoying a cup of coffee every now and again. And I know for parents, especially of young kids, you might say, I can't get through a cup of coffee. I have to set it down. I have to go deal with the fight or deal with the laundry or deal with supper or dishes. And then I get back to it and my coffee's cold. And that leaves us feeling depleted and drained. And you know what? Some days and some seasons, it might just be not possible. But I would really encourage you, again, this doesn't have to be big moments of self-care. They can be tiny moments that you need to be very intentional in taking, right? And it might just be those few minutes of enjoying a cup of coffee or a cup of tea. You get the kids in front of Paw Patrol, or maybe they're quietly playing in the backyard for that 5 minutes in the day where everything is going well. Take advantage of that time, right? Sometimes as parents, we think, oh, the kids are occupied. Everyone's doing well. I'm going to go get the laundry started. I'm going to start making dinner. I'm going to vacuum upstairs. I'm going to clean the bathroom. The to-do list is never ending. We know that. And I know all those things are important. They need to get done. But it's an issue of priority. Can you make yourself a priority as a parent, even if it's for 5 minutes, to sit down, to make a cup of coffee or tea, and just enjoy a moment? Enjoy a moment thinking, reflecting, looking out the window, being peaceful, enjoying that moment, because it's not going to last, but you need it to build your capacity into your life. We need moments of self-care if we're going to care well for our kids. Okay, so that's it for the actual webinar. I just wanna take a moment to pray for you and to thank God for you as a parent. I hope that this has been encouraging to you or has helped you maybe in your thinking, in your parenting. And I hope certainly that it strengthens your parenting and strengthens your family, that maybe in some way it reminds you that there is a way that you can increase your capacity by putting these values into practice. So let's pray together. Our gracious God and Heavenly Father, I just come before you and I thank you for the gift of our children, for the gift of family. It is a beautiful gift. But God, it's sometimes the hardest thing that we do in our lives, that we are engaging in life with these young lives that you've given to us. And it's difficult. It's hard. And we only have a certain amount of capacity and we fail. We're not perfect. But God, you know that. And you're writing a story of redemption in our lives. You're writing a story of restoration. And I pray that you would keep writing that story in us personally and that you'd be writing that story into our families. Would you help us to be able to lean on you and to lean on others, to be able to increase our own capacity and support as parents, but to also maximize the impact that we can have on our kids' lives. And ultimately, Lord God, we realize that you are the parent, the ultimate parent of our children, that you are with them in every moment of every day. In those times and places that we can't be with them, you are with them. And we are mindful, Lord God, that you are leading us and you are leading our children. So I pray a prayer of blessing upon us as parents and upon our families. May we look to you for our hope, for our strength, and for our endurance in this life. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you so much for joining us. God bless you and keep you in your parenting.